Welcome sa isa na namang edisyon ng Kuya Kim Atienza Vlog. At dahil Holy Week ngayon, medyo iba ang format ng ating vlog ngayon. Imbis na the usual trivia, bisikleta, motorsiklo, ngayon magkukwento ko. At ang ikukwento ko ay ang buhay ko. Paano ba nadiskubre ni Kuya Kim si Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Holy Week ngayon eh, so tamang-tama lang. Enjoy the vlog, si Kuya Kim! Hindi pangit, wow. Hindi rin gwapo. Sakto lang. Ito po si Kuya Kim. Kim San Mida!
Opa!
Alam niyo, si Kuya Kim has been a Christian for the past 7 years. It was 2013 when I accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I've always been very religious. I was born a Catholic. I actually entered the seminary in high school. For 2 years, nag-aral ako sa seminaryo, Don Bosco Seminary. I really wanted to be a priest. Natuwa ang parents ko noon. And I grew up with Jesus Christ as my best friend. I would talk to Him all the time. I'd pray to Him. Whenever I was sad, whenever I was happy, kausap ko siya palagi. But like any best friend, ang best friend kasi kahit na injanin mo, may masama kang gawin, he's always going to be there because he was my best friend. Up until college, prayer was always a habit for me. I would pray to him all the time. I studied film and audiovisual communications in UP. Ang pinakapangarap ko sa buhay ay maging TV star. Not to be a director, not to be a scriptwriter, not to be a producer, but to be on camp. Ang peg ko nga, Agamulak eh. I wanted to be like Agamulak or Richard Gomez. I prayed to the Lord all the time to get my first break. I remember I auditioned in all the commercial auditions. I went to all the go-sees. Rejected ako palagi. I was never hired for any commercial. As I always say, hindi naman ako pangit. Hindi naman ako gwapo. Sakto lang. And sakto lang had no place. In the 80s, you had to be super handsome. But they discovered that I had a good voice pala. So I auditioned for voice commercials. And I did a lot of voice commercials back in the 80s. And 90s. Ako si Red Mask, dun sa Maskman, Ultraman, si Magmaman. Ayan ang mga unang trabaho ko sa ABS-CBN. At marami pang iba. And all the time, I was praying to the Lord to give me that first break on television. After college, my dad, who was a politician then, my dad was the vice mayor of Manila then, told me, Kim, baka naman gusto mo pumasok sa politika. So inisip ko, parang TV rin naman yun. May exposure din ako. Pasok na rin ako sa politika. So I ran for barangay chairman in barangay 768, zone 83, in San Andres Bukid. And I won as barangay chairman. After one term as barangay chairman, I was city councilor in district 5 in Manila. That's Malate. During my stint in the city council, my first term, I was happy. But the second term, I felt that I was lacking. I was not a pure politician. I was in it for the wrong reasons. Eh. I was in politics because I love my family, because I love my dad. But I was not a clean politician. Like most politicians, I would take money here and there. And then in my mind, gagamitin ko naman tong pera to para sa taong bayan din. Ipapamigay ko rin naman to pagdating ng kampanya. But it was not clean money. And that's not good. So there was always this conviction inside me that what I was doing was not correct. A time came when my dad was graduating as a mayor of Manila. Kailangan niya ng kapalit. At ang papalit ay ako. Now coming from the city council, mayor na kaagad, parang masyadong mabigat ang talon. So I went to one of my friends in ABS-CBN, who was a boss then, and I told him, I want to get exposure on TV. That's how my TV career started. In the morning show, in Magandang Umaga Bayan, kailangan niya ng Steve Irwin, si Crocodile Hunter. He was the Australian guy. And he wore this hat. Yan ang simula nitong sombrerong to. In the morning show, yung Magandang Umaga Bayan, you need a Steve Irwin there. I can talk about animals. I can wrestle with mga animals in Manila Zoo. I can show snakes and reptiles. And it will be a big hit. Then I told my friend pa, who was a boss in ABS-CBN, bro, you don't even have to pay me. As a matter of fact, I can call all these Manila businesses like Paggor and they can support the segment. Since wala naman akong bayad at meron pang sponsor yung segment, they got me in. That was my first break in Magandang Umaga Bayan, a segment called Animalandia. So I was so happy doing it and I was getting the exposure, yet my agenda was not to be on television for good, but my agenda was to get elected as the next mayor of Manila to replace my dad. After about 3 or 4 months of doing my segment Animalandia, I was already doing interviews then. Meron na akong taped segment, meron pa akong live segment in the studio. My boss Maria Reza, who was the head of news and current affairs, talked to me then and told me, Kim, I know exactly what you're doing. You are using news and current affairs for your political agenda because you're running for office looking. But I want you to work for me, sabi ni Maria Reza. She got me a contract. She said, show me a contract. If you sign this contract, I shall pay you and you will work for ABS-CBN. But if you want to run for politics, then you have no space whatsoever here in news and current affairs. I will not allow it. Make a choice. I told Maria, Maria, I'm so honored, I'm so flattered, but give me time to think. Mahirap yun eh. The first thing I did when I went home that day was I went to Malate Church and I prayed to my best friend, Jesus Christ, and I told him, Jesus Christ, give me a sign. You're God. Give me a sign. Hinamon ko ang best friend ko. A few days passed and I was assigned in the morning show to interview Ka Ernie Baron, the walking encyclopedia. I went to his house, yung bahay niya dun sa Parañaque, and I talked to him. Interview ko siya. Kasama ko si Maring Winnie, Tita Winnie Cordero. Magandang umaga, bayan! Magandang umaga, Ka Ernie Baron. Nandito si Kuya Kim ngayon para bigyan kayo ng award. I was going to give him an award sa broadcaster. Ang sabi ng matanda, bata, alikaw po ka rito. Ang buhay, may hangganan. Si Ka Ernie Baron, pwede na akong mamatay dahil meron ang papalit sa akin. Ikaw ang papalit sa akin. I was dumbfounded. I was shocked. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to say. Si Tito Winnie, umiyak live. Hindi ko alam. Sinif kong energy ko, pinasaya ko. Ka Ernie Baron, okay magsalita ng ganyan. Sabi ng matanda, ito lang ang ipangako mo sa akin. Mahalin mo ang trabahong binigay ko, ang buhay ko. Ikaw ang papalit sa akin. Pwede na akong mamatay. I had to go to church to talk to my best friend. And I prayed, Jesus Christ, that was a sign. But you're God. Show me a stronger sign. That's what I told him. Dumada naman ang isa, dalawa, tatlong araw. This is January 23 and January 24 was my birthday. My executive producer, Noel Ferrer, called me. Tomorrow, your birthday, wala kang party ha sa show. We'd have to assign you to the house of Ka Ernie Baron. Sabi ko, bakit? Eh kasi namatay siya. You'll have to be assigned to his wake. I was in shock. Namatay si Ka Ernie Baron sa birthday ko. At sinabi niya, ako ang papalit sa kanya. And this is live on TV. Nakatape ito, nandun to sa mga archives ng ABS-CBN. And that was a sign. Ang sabi ni Lord, Kim, pag hindi mo pa nakuha yan, hello. So again, I prayed to my best friend and I said, bigyan mo ako ng lakas na loob na sabihin ko sa tatay ko na mayor ng Maynila na ang papalitan ko ay si Ka Ernie Baron at hindi siya. But what I did was, I invited my father over to my house for breakfast to tell him because I decided already that I wanted to be on television and no more politics for me. Dad, hindi ko masabi. Dad, ang sabi ng tatay ko, anak, you don't have to tell me. Whenever I watch you on television, I see how happy you are. And whenever I see you in City Hall, I can see that you're not happy. You don't have to tell me. I know it's hurting you. I give you my blessing. Ako, ang nanay mo, ang pamilya mo, we'll be okay. Don't worry about us. I gave my dad a big hug. I was crying. We were both emotional. I also realized that my dad, being more than a politician, was a father first and foremost, wanting nothing but the best for his son. So I signed the contract. I became a part of ABS-CBN. And that was the first day of my stint. This was in 2004. And then I was so in love with my work. They gave me UKG Showtime, which was a morning show then. Batanglawin, my own show. And then I had TV Patrol. I had 4 shows. And I was so in love with it. I was so passionate with it because it was something that I really wanted to do. And I forgot about my health. Trabaho lang na trabaho na trabaho na kalimutan kong balusugan ko. Up until one day, this was August in 2010. I was brushing my teeth and then, like a switch, I suffered a stroke. The stroke hit the left frontal lobe of my brain. I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know who I was. Hindi ko alam kung nasan ako. All I knew in my head was, there's something wrong. So I started running outside the bathroom. Tinawag ko ang kasambahay ko. Only to realize that I didn't have a voice. Wala akong boses. Hindi ako makasigaw. I was naked, by the way. My driver, who had the presence of mind, brought me to the nearest hospital, which was PGH. Ang haba ng pila sa PGH sa emergency room. My wife, who knew I was having a stroke, was able to call a friend in Makati Med, and I was brought to Makati Med within 3 hours. I was given that medicine to make the blood flow in the brain. There's a 3-hour window. So, bumalik. I couldn't talk for a few days. I was stupid for many, many days. I was in ICU for 10 days. And when I was in ICU, I prayed to my best friend, Jesus Christ. I said, Jesus Christ, if you make me well, pagalingin mo lang ako. Then I'll be the best Kim I can be. I'll be the most fit Kim I can be. I just don't want to suffer another stroke. And after a few months, I became well. I had a 30-minute walking program, which I did. And then the walk became a run. And I was running longer and longer distances. And 6 months after my stroke, I ran 21K already. 1 year after my stroke, I ran my first full marathon in Bordeaux, France. This was my deal with my best friend, that if he made me well, I'll be the best Kim I can be. I became fit. I became a triathlete. And I tried to be the best triathlete I can be. 3 years after my stroke, I was ready for my first full Ironman. I signed up for Busselton Australia, Ironman Western Australia or IMWA. A full Ironman is a 3.8 kilometer swim, followed by a 180 kilometer bike, and then followed by a 42 kilometer run. I was training for it and I was so fit and I knew I was gonna finish it in maybe 12 hours or less. After a 7-hour bike, 7 hours kung magbike kami sa isang araw eh, I realized that my hands were paralyzed. I couldn't move my hands. I went to my doctor, being a stroke survivor, and I asked, "Doc, am I suffering another stroke? I don't want to suffer another stroke. My hands are paralyzed." She checked my hands and said, "Baka you were in this bike position for a long time. That's your ulnar nerve, your hand nerve. Naipit lang yan. Give it a day or two and you'll be okay." I said, "Doc, okay." So the next day, I did a 26 kilometer run. And I realized there was something wrong with my balance. I couldn't balance well. When I removed my shoes that morning, my toes were like this. My toes were also paralyzed. And I knew this was not my hand nerve because my feet were also paralyzed. I went back to Dr. Ana Nolido, my neurologist. They took a nerve test that was very painful. They got a spinal tap. They took some protein from my spinal cord. And then she told me, "Kim, I have to put you in ICU right now. You have a rare nerve disorder called Guillain-Barré syndrome or GBS. The paralysis is acting very quickly. By this afternoon, your diaphragm might be paralyzed already. When that happens, we'd have to put tube down your throat, tracheotomy." When I was in ICU, I was in shock. Just yesterday, I was Ironman. I ran 26 kilometers. 2 days ago, I biked 7 hours. And now I'm looking at intubation and total paralysis. And this rare disease called Guillain-Barré syndrome, life turned 180 degrees on me. And I could not understand what was happening. I cried to my best friend and I asked him, "Jesus Christ, you gave me a stroke and then you made me well. Now that I'm well, you're making me paralyzed. What do you want? What do you want from me?" And I was emotional. For some reason, a friend who's a Christian, Karen Davila, came to visit and said, "Kim, you're crying. What's happening?" I told her what was happening and my complaint to my best friend, Jesus Christ. And then she shared to me, "You know, Kim, Paul the Apostle had a thorn in his flesh. He had something that pained him all the time. He was always sick. And he prayed to the Lord that he said, 'Lord, remove this thorn from my flesh.' And then God told Paul, 'My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness.' And then it dawned on me. You know, the mug of Ironman had the motto of Ironman then, which is, 'I can. I can swim, I can bike, I can run.' The t-shirts, my training shirts had, 'I can.' My bathroom mirror had a post-it, had a note that said, 'I can.' My phone said, 'I can,' to remind me that I can. That morning in ICU, I realized that I couldn't. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't even move my hands and I was waiting to be paralyzed. And then I realized, only God can. His grace is all I need. And His power is made perfect in my weakness. And that morning, I was weak and I needed Him. And I prayed to Him and I said, 'I get it, Lord God. I can't do anything. It's You that I need.'" And when Karen left, I called one of my best friends, Rica Paraleo, and I told Rica, "Rica, bistahin mo ako sa hospital. O, may sakit ka na naman. Bring your husband, Pastor Joe Bonifacio, her husband." They went to the hospital and I told Joe and Rica, "I want to get to know more about Jesus Christ." It was that morning in Makati Med, in August 2013, that I finally accepted Jesus Christ, not only as best friend, but that morning, I realized that He is the source of all my power, that He is my Lord, and He is my Savior, and I accepted Him. He still is my best friend, but He's also my boss. And I know that there's nothing I can do without Him. And it's so comforting because He takes care of me. And that was the time when I turned to Christ and I became Christian. After I accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I repented from all my sins. Life turned to be beautiful again. I got well again. I became a faster runner, a faster cyclist, a faster swimmer. I became a better dad. I became a better husband. But more than that, I knew exactly where my power comes from. I am nothing. I can't do anything. Only God can. His power is made perfect in my weakness, and His grace is all I need. I decided to share to you my testimony. There is power in testimony. If it touches you and you decide to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior as well, message, keep in touch with me and I'll help you, I'll guide you along.
Opa!
So that's the story of how Kuya Kim became Christian in time for Holy Week. Thank you very much. It's God's will for me to share my story to as many people I can. And it's His will for me to share this with you, especially now that it's Holy Saturday and tomorrow is Easter. I thank you for following me in my vlog. And I'd like to end this vlog, as always, with a blessing from the Book of Numbers. May God bless you. May God keep you. May God shine His face on you. May He be gracious to you. May He turn to you. May He give you and your family peace. Ito po si Kuya Kim. Kim Sanmina.
Opa!